couldn't care who less who wins the thing. Doesn't matter to me whatsoever. But I'll tell you, when the push comes to shove and the showdown comes, I want to be able to have some confidence in the Lord, knowing He's going to come through, and knowing that things have been in order, and knowing how God operates, that He's never going to be unholy to bless you, that knowing now, in His holiness, He can still bless me, I want to have confidence in the Lord. Brother, when it gets that close, and I can't have confidence in the Lord, that's rough. The way of transgressors is hard. And you know something that's not just one thing or one way, but it's like it's all the way and every day and all the week and all the time. It's like for somebody not living right and transgressing against the Word of God, it's like his wickedness is following him and he knows it. And the thing can show up any moment, the most expected, unexpected time or place. It's like here's somebody trying to fight the Lord and fight the Word of God. And the Bible says the stars in their courses fought against Sisera in Judges chapter 5. And listen, God, if he's got to use his stars, he's going to fight against any wicked man. He'll fight against you. I want to have confidence knowing God's going to come through. Not he's going to pass judgment against me. And you know when you stop and think of that, the way the transgressor is hard. And yet, one of the things that amazes me, and you think, man, everybody you know, you deal with them, you show them the Word of God, this is how it's going to go. You think, man, it'd be falling on their face, it'd be repenting all over the place. You ever stop and think how a few of them really turn away from their sins? And how many of them turn away from sins and learn to hate evil, like the Bible says. Ye that love the Lord, hate evil. And turn from your sin. And mean it. And repent of your sin. You think you'd do it all over the place. But they can know that they're hurting themselves and grieving God and still not repent of their sins. Now don't forget, Proverbs 13:15. Good understanding giveth favor. That being the sight of God and man. Giveth favor, but the way of transgressors is hard. Want to make it rough on yourself? Well, some of y'all just keep going like you're going. You're going to find out what it's all about. And want God's favor? And straighten up and fly right. Okay, let's have a word of prayer and close out. They've learned something, don't even know it. And see, you're not like a confined audience where I can give you a message, you know, 45 minutes, you're going to sit there and listen. They're not. But you just put it on them, and 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 they got it. And then somewhere the Lord does something with it, and you don't know where it'll be. It might be in this town, it might be in another town, it might be 5 years from now, it might be a month from now, you don't know. See, but you just stay with it. Now, same thing is true of your Christian life. You just plod along. See, you just keep on, keep on, keep on doing right. And the thing says that the soul of sluggard desireth hath nothing, the soul of diligent shall be made fat. Now, the problem with being a sluggard, it's a problem of a lot of preachers. And a sluggard is somebody, according to what you got there, he wants what someone else has. But, you know, even like a lot of preachers, they want it handed to them. They see some preacher, and, man, a guy's got a church of 500 people. I'd sure like to have a church of 500 people. And they think somebody's just going to take and set you and plant you right in a church of 500 people. It doesn't work that way, see? They desire, they have nothing. You get out, and instead of being a sluggard, you slug it out, see? You be a slugger instead of a slugger. Yeah, different? That pretty well explained the thing. But a lot of people are that way. I mean, they see something like the black folk, they see what the white folk have, and they desire it. You know, as far as work comes, you know, if a white man's got some work to do and he doesn't get things done, man, he gets ulcers over it. And a colored man, he lays right down beside it and goes to sleep. But you know, he's got the desire, and he wants your TVs and your automobiles and everything else you got. He wants it just like you got it. And maybe, you know, you're somebody you want like someone else has it. And you see someone having it. You take Brian here. He piles around here in about a 1980 or 81 automobile. That poor fellow, he's lucky if he don't go to sleep on the road. He's out there working, working, slugging it out, see? Now you got a choice, either be a slugger or a slugger. And in the Bible, you know, it's a fight. And you stay in the fight, and, you know, you just go through the battle, you slug it out. The Lord in the Bible speaks about soldiers, being a good soldier. And the Lord calls you soldiers because you're in a fight. And you're going to have to stay in the fight and be a slugger. I knew a preacher one time, he used to come around this place all the time. And every time he came, he always wanted something. And I'd give him tracts, give him Bibles, give him everything I could give him. But he wanted that plus some money. Well, it just never worked out where he could get a cut of the pie. He was always wanting a cut of the pie. Never worked out that way. Some guy come to know the fella, and he's every time I see this guy, he describes and tells me about him again. And the story is that he says, hey, Brother Art, says, that fella, he liked to have what you got, but he didn't want to go through what you did to get it. He liked to kind of sit on the throne and push the button and have everybody, one guy do this, another guy do this, and someone else do this, while he sits back and does nothing but push buttons. And it don't work out well. I don't care if you're a preacher. I don't care if you're a factory worker. I don't care what it is. I mean, you name anything you get into, you always got the person that wants to make the top, but he wants to make it riding on in the easy way. Get in there and slug it out. I don't care what you wind up doing, but listen, get in the battle, stay in the battle, slug it out, and don't be a lazy, good-for-nothing bum, no matter what it is. The slugger just desires. Everybody has desires, but if you want to have something, go on and get it the right way. Number five, it says, a righteous man hateth lying, but a wicked man is loathsome and cometh to shame. Now, a righteous man hateth lying. In the Bible, David mentions something about like that. Oh, go to Psalm 119. He mentions it about three times there. Well, I'm sure he mentions a lot more than that, but look at verse number 29 of Psalm 119. Number 29 says, remove from me the way of lying. Remove, he don't want it. Don't want anything connected with it. Remove from me the way of lying and grant me thy law graciously. Why does he say that? Look at verse 163, same psalm there, 163. He said, I hate and abhor lying, but thy law do I love. Now go back to 128, same chapter again, same psalm, 128. Therefore I esteem all thy precepts concerning all things to be right, and I hate every false way. He says, I abhor lying, and he says, I hate every false way. You know why? Because he seems like he's around the truth. The truth means something to him. Look at 140, for example. Thy word is very pure, therefore thy servant loveth it. Loves one thing, hates another. One's true, one's false, one's in error. Loves the truth. You ought to be the same way. In Proverbs, go back to Proverbs chapter 30. A fellow by the name of Agur. Proverbs chapter 30, look at verse number 8. Remove far from me vanity and lies. Well, nothing to do with it. Remove far from me. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with food convenient for me. First part of the verse, remove far from me vanity and lies. But look what 5 and 6 deals with. Every word of God is pure. So he gets around the word of God, and it wants nothing to do with something false or a lie. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them put their trust in him. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. And as far as I can see from the proverb there, it appears as though the stronger you are on the word of God, the more you hate lying. And the weaker you are in the Bible, the more you receive anything. Doesn't matter if someone lies or you lie, it don't matter. But somebody who's strong on the Bible, they get where they resent lying, they don't like it, they hate it, they abhor it. They're like the Lord is. He's that way about it. He sets abomination unto him. He hates it. There's David there in Psalm 119, the longest chapter in your Bible, all deals with the Word of God. Here's a man by the name of Agur there talking about the Word of God and how pure it is. And he says he hates and abhors it too. And so it looks like the stronger a person is on the Bible, the more they hate the error and the false way and especially the lie. All right, now Proverbs 13, verse number 6. No, I didn't come finish the verse here. Loathsome, last part of the verse. 5, a wicked man is loathsome. Loathsome is a hateful or disgusting type of a person, evidently, and says he's wicked, evidently in the sense of lying. As far as I can figure out, the thing it says, and then, of course, cometh to shame. Number 6, righteousness keepeth him that is upright in the way, but wickedness overthroweth the sinner. Last verse of chapter number 12, along the same lines as far as the righteous are concerned. Righteousness is, he's in the way of life, of the way of righteousness is life. That type of thing, kind of comparable there. Now, in verse number 6, look at the end there, wickedness overthroweth the sinner. don't know if you ever done much personal work. These fellows go to the jailhouse, and they have some of y'all go on the street, and you have some of y'all on the job you have. But you probably have done enough. I imagine about everybody here has done enough witnessing that you couldn't in a million years convince them that they're destroying themselves. That thing says, wickedness overthroweth the sinner. You ever try and convince them of that? They think that, hey, man, I am living, man, I am free. They act like they're on the top of it. And they are heading all the way to the bottom. But to convince them that they're destroying themselves, they just think the brakes are going against me, everybody's against me, why didn't he get a raise, I didn't get a raise, why didn't he get a promotion, I didn't get a promotion. They're destroying themselves. But it's sometimes hard to convince them that way. Number seven, there is it make themselves rich yet hath nothing. There is it make themselves poor yet hath great riches. Maketh himself rich. It's maybe a thing like back there in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse number 17. It says, they that will be rich bring themselves into a snare, and that type of thing, love money. And anyhow, it's will be rich. It's where a person, his will is determined that in this life, he is going to get rich. And whenever somebody has determined that, they go to, it doesn't matter who they hurt or no matter how they get it, they're just determined to get it by hook or by crook, to step on somebody, to hurt somebody, it does not matter. They're just determined to get rich. And the Bible says there's people like that. It says, maketh himself rich. Now, I'm not against somebody being rich, but, you know, maybe the Lord wants you to have something, maybe he don't. And, you know, you can enjoy life not having very much. You don't have to be rich. In fact, a lot of people have money, the money's got them. They don't enjoy it at all. And so you better let the Lord, you know, steer the way and guide you. And if it so befalls you that you know, make out okay that way, all well and good. But just to determine that I am going to be rich and I am going to become a millionaire, and I'm going to compete with Wendy's, McDonald's, and Burger King and the next 50 hamburger joints, you're crazy. You're crazy. You're going to find out, you get out there and it'll be just like the Bible says, hath nothing. Whenever the money or the riches get a hold of a person, good and strong, it's a situation where it becomes a burden to them. I knew a fellow told me, he said he was a millionaire. And yet, I wouldn't really consider that fellow my idol, as close as any. But, you know, according to the way the world say that, he wouldn't really be my idol in this life. He got the riches. But, you know, sometimes it becomes a burden. And it's a burden along these lines of how to keep it. You got it, how are you going to keep it? And you got it, how are you going to keep others from getting it? And when you got it, how are you going to know who a real friend is? You know, somebody's loaded with money, I mean, they have all kinds of friends. But how are you going to decipher who's just tagging along because you got something and they want to get in the grab bag? I mean, suppose you fellas had a lot of money and you got ready to get married. I know you never had to worry about, you know, I mean, there's nobody going to marry you for your money, but suppose, you know, someone like that had a lot of money and they'd be afraid to get married because somebody might be marrying them for their money. Says he make himself rich and hath nothing. And, you know, somebody's always, you know, in there trying to get a slice of it. And so you got problems. You got problems. It'll be kind of like having a flower without fragrance. You know, like having a silk flower. It looks real good. But you go up and try to, you know, get a, you know, real good sweet smell out of that thing and get the honeybees to make some honey off of it, there's nothing there. I mean, just grab a little piece of cardboard and same thing. As far as smelling's concerned. I want, you know, look a little bit better, but that's what happens sometimes. So you want to let the Lord lead you in your lifetime. And here's Andrea. She's going to go to school there. She's going to go to the University of Tennessee, and she's going to live at home, and she'll probably do all right. She'll probably do all right. Knowing Andrea, she'll probably go in there and come out of the thing okay. But, you know, you got to be careful. Got to be real careful. And you got to pray. You got to find out what the Lord wants. And maybe the Lord can do more with you without the money than with it. Now, I realize it takes money, and I'm thankful for the people still working, still putting money in the pot, and, you know, I can say $1,400 offering. It's got to come from somewhere. And yet, by the same token, you know, maybe the Lord can just grab your heart and hold you still and get your attention if you don't have much. Maybe do better that way. Maybe you have, you just sort of forget about the Lord like a lot of people do. I don't know. Just let the Lord do it. But it says, hath nothing. Now, especially if somebody is spiritually poor, then you can have all the other stuff. I mean, what good is it anyhow? You'd say someone that has no more than the material possessions of this world, and spiritually they're in poverty, you'd say someone like that, really by Bible standards, would be a beggar, a beggar, a beggar, a beggar, all the way. And so it says, hath nothing. Theirs that make themselves poor, yet hath great riches. Evidently, here's somebody that as fast as it comes in, goes out. And it says, make themselves poor, so evidently guys go on. The thing comes, you know, they're just faithfulness comes right through like that. And but payday one day comes along. And it says, hath great riches. And I don't know exactly what those riches might be, but evidently he's got something money can't buy. One has something only money can buy, and so they don't have nothing. And here's somebody else, they've got something money can't buy, and the Bible says they've got great riches. Some of y'all don't have a lot. How about some promises you can claim? My God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. You know, if you can claim that, you've got a lot going for you. Some people, you know, money comes in, or come in one, you know, they're real honest about the thing before the Lord. They don't delay to put things in. They cover everything real good. And the Bible says back there in Matthew chapter number 6, you got treasures in heaven. That's quite a promise. I mean, people down here can't say that. They can't say it's waiting for me up there. They might have waiting for me in the bank or somewhere else, but not up there. And so it says, make themselves poor and hath great riches. So make sure, though, that if you're going to make yourself poor, that your motive is right. There are people that give, and they give because they feel like there's a return that's promised. And if I put $10 in, I can count on God giving me back $1,000. You know, like old Shambuck preached the other day on the radio, you know, man. This lady gave him the rent money. And she came the next week and gave him another $100. A tithe off $1,000. God gave the lady $1,000. Yeah, I got thinking about that. That guy's a real, real slicky, man. You know, when he preached that thing was on about the 28th or 29th of May, right when rent money is saved up and just about to be paid, and a dude comes off talking about somebody giving rent money to him. Boy, you talk about some serpents, man. You got them all over the radio. Well, anyhow, if you give, make sure you give because of the right motive, because you love the Lord. Now, we go on to verse number 8. Verse number 8. The ransom of man's life are his riches, but the poor heareth not rebuke. It appears as though a ransom is the price it takes to make you free, and it appears like some people, their riches do it. It appears like sometimes they don't get retribution like they should because they're riches. Their riches seem to get them through. I knew a fellow one time gave a young man a break, and but when he arrested a man from the head of a couple of steel mills in town, he didn't give him a break. They called the fellow in on the carpet, man, and this is in the police department now. They called him in on the carpet, and you don't arrest those guys. You know what it is? Them guys pay off time, you know. And this guy didn't care. He's just crazy enough, man. Your name can be Umstad or White or Black or Brown or whatever else. It didn't make any difference, man. He'd still, you know, write you up. And but he'd give a break to just, you know, nobody. And they called him in on the thing. That sometimes works that way. Sometimes somebody's riches, they are able to get out of some retribution. The last part of the verse says, but the poor heareth not rebuke. It's like a poor man, he doesn't, there's no risk of a threat for him. He heareth not rebuke. Kind of different than verse number 1 here. It's like, you know, who cares about him? He doesn't have to hear that kind of stuff as far as ransom and that type of talk. He doesn't even hear it. Number 9, the light of the righteous rejoiceth, but the lamp of the wicked shall be put out. Okay, the light of the righteous. Our light is what? Who, rather, not what. Well, what, too? The Bible, for one. Who be the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, our light. That'd be the two sources of our light. Now, that being true, it says, the light of the righteous rejoiceth. All right? both those, you take the Lord Jesus and the Word of God itself, both of them cause rejoicing to your heart. Take the Bible, the light you get from the Bible. It does the same thing as the Lord Jesus Christ does. It guides you along the pathway of life. It instructs you along the way. It rejoices your heart. Always good to know some Bible, learn some Bible. Always a blessing to you, cause you to rejoice. Go back to an illustration of the Bible in 2 Chronicles. Look at chapter 9 and verse 7. This is the story of Solomon, all of his wisdom that he had. The Bible says the men who was round about him, they were happy, and they were happy continually. And you and I have an ability now. We've got a Bible. Take the Bible home with us. Can read and get something from the Word of God continually. You got a chance for some great rejoicing. Don't blow the opportunity. 2 Chronicles chapter 9, verse 7. Solomon now and Queen of Sheba, and she sees what sense the fellow has. She says, "Happy are thy men, happy are these thy servants which stand continually before thee and hear thy wisdom." All right, suppose that was true of you and the Word of God. Suppose you just faithfully, day in, day out, stood before the Word of God, and suppose you prayed before you went in, and you read, and you got everything you get from God as far as the Word's concerned. Don't think there wouldn't be rejoicing along the way. You fill up the Word of God, and you fill up the wisdom, and get some sense about you. You can be sure, man, that thing's going to bring rejoicing in your heart. The light of the righteous, that's what your light is. Two things, Jesus, one, the Bible, number two. All right? Last part of the verse there, but the lamp of the wicked shall be put out. Now, look at a couple places in Proverbs. Go to Proverbs chapter 20 and look at verse number 20. Proverbs 20, verse 20. Whoso curseth his father or his mother, his lamp shall be put out in obscure darkness. Now, honor thy father and thy mother brings promise, Old Testament, New Testament, and cursing father and mother brings some bad promises in Proverbs, Deuteronomy, places like that. Look at chapter 24, verse number 20. Proverbs 24, verse 20. For there shall be no reward to the evil man, the candle of the wicked shall be put out. All right, looks like what light they think they have, it seems like it turns out to be darkness. The Bible says the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God. The Bible speaks about being reserved under chains of darkness. The Bible speaks about outer darkness. The Bible speaks about a mist of darkness for them. The Bible speaks about thick darkness for them, all those terms. But they're all dealing with darkness as far as a lost person is concerned. It'll be a very, very terrible thing. The lamp of the wicked shall be put out. Number 10. Says, only by pride cometh contention, but with the well-advised is wisdom. Now, you say, how can that be? Only by pride cometh contention. Well, it's real simple. You know, if there's a point of contention, one person is right and one person is wrong. Now, if there are two opposite feelings along a certain line, they can't both be right. One's right, one's wrong. Now, especially you take somebody who's saved. You ever stop and think of things? You got the Holy Spirit inside of you saying, green light, red light, stop, go, right, wrong, yes, no, good, evil. And you can't miss. And whenever that thing says, red light, stop, whoa, you're dead wrong. And yet, in the heat of the argument, you keep right on rolling, or keep right on rolling, and insist that you're right. You know what that is? It's pride. And whenever you have contention, you deal with somebody that's just filled with pride. They're saved, and they've got the Holy Spirit of God in them. God, the Holy Spirit, is dealing with them on the inside, and somebody's wrong and knows they're wrong, but they're too proud to admit they're wrong. You know, that's kind of hard. That's pretty hard to do sometimes, especially it's hard to do between husband and wife if you're the husband. Probably is for the wife, too, but I wouldn't know that side of it. But for the husband, you know, it's hard to tell a woman that I am wrong, I've sinned, or I'm wrong, forgive me. That's hard to do. But it can be done. And if God the Holy Spirit puts some conviction on your heart, just go on and play it safe and admit it. You know, sometimes the Lord put conviction on me and I feel like, well, I know she's wrong. She's not listening now, so we don't want her to hear this. I know she's wrong, but, you know, the conviction's still there, and even though I know she's wrong, I don't know where the things come from, but I just go on and admit it anyhow and just say, I'm wrong, forgive me. I'm going to play it safe. Only by pride cometh contention. Now, I marked down some things here, yeah, with the well advised. In the Bible, illustration B, for example, Rehoboam. Rehoboam goes to the old men, asks for counsel. And things, you know, kind of getting a little bit of trouble here. The nation kind of rebelling against him there. And things weren't going quite as smooth as it did under Solomon. And so Rehoboam, he asked for some counsel. And the old men, they say, well, son, I tell you what, I think you better go a little bit easy on him. You're getting a little bit on the rough side here. But give him a break here. Give him a little breathing room. And he says, well, I'll tell you what I'll do. I think I'll just go, I'll go talk to the young men too. So he goes to the old and he goes to the young. And the Bible says he listened to them young men and said, hey, make it tough on them, man. Make it tough what you can. And the Bible says he forsook the counsel of the old man. You got a nation goes in rebellion over the thing, and man, he practically lose a nation. 10 tribes, man. I mean, they split off because the fellow's not going to listen to any counsel, and only by pride cometh contention. That's just an illustration, kind of a small illustration of the Bible. You have other illustrations, but that's just one. Last part of the verse says, with the well-advised is wisdom. Now, they're well-advised as far as how to suppress it, see? I mean, it's easy to, you know, cause trouble, cause contention. And somebody's well-advised, they got some sense of how to squelch it, how to keep it down, how to keep it under. With the well-advised is wisdom. Now, amongst other things, I guess I consider myself an advisor. When I say that, I don't ever marry anybody without, first of all, talking with them, counseling with them, and just being, you know, it's advice. With the well-advised is wisdom. So along the marriage lines, I definitely do that. All right, now, I deal with them all the way from the foundation, all the way through, and some things dealing with the flesh and fidelity and fearing God and finances, stuff like that. And also when I get done dealing with the women and with the men, I deal with them about fighting. You say, before they get married? Yeah, before they get married. Because you know somewhere along the line, it's bound to happen. And contention about something's going to come in. And so I just sort of give them some clues, you know, about this business contention and what to do, how to avoid it. But I remind them that only by pride cometh contention. Only. Are you fellows hearing me? Are you women hearing me? Only by pride cometh contention. Like I said, if you're saved, you got God dealing with you. And you know when you're wrong. No sense trying to cover it up. All right? Also, talk to them about their relationship. And I don't know if you ever think about it, you know, every now and then, Shirley and I, we don't fight. But every now and then, you know, a little contention. Getting fewer and far between, I guess, as time goes on. She'd give up, or I'd give up, or the Bible's helping, or something. Sure did help to get saved, I'll say that. Anyhow, what you need to realize is that your relationship is more important than any issue you ever face. You know that? Those issues seem like they're so critical. Oh, no, they're not. Your relationship is more important than who's right and who's wrong. You know that? And sometimes in those contentions, you just gotta bite your tongue. I got a way of biting my tongue, you know, and I just sort of, you know, kind of let her know I'm biting my tongue, you know. I'm mad as all get out. I'd sure like to say something, but I just sort of shut my mouth. I guess I should do it. You know, the Bible says when you fast, wash your face, and only let them know you're fasting. I should probably just say, don't let her know I'm biting my tongue. See that? I'm biting it. Well, she's not listening, so that's good. Sometimes, you know, you swallow your pride. Sometimes you take a walk. Say, where are you going to go? I'm going to go outside and cool off. You know why? Because your relationship is more important than the contention and who's right and who's wrong. I talked to him about avoiding fights. You know how you avoid them? Well, in case you weren't advised before you got married, I'll tell you how to avoid them. One of the ways you avoid them is by not being a gnat strainer. After all, I mean, are you perfect? I know I am.